justice delayed.
Justice delayed.
Injustice denied.
Injustice denied.
Our future.
Our future.
Hangs in the balance.
Hangs in the balance.
Our children's future.
Our children's future.
Hangs in the balance.
Hangs in the balance.
And nothing.
And nothing.
Today, on February 13, 2010, we consider the strong momentum, the excitement across the state for today's historic Thousand on Jones Street People Assembly under the theme, "For Our Children, We Must Say Never Again to Desegregation. We demand more education, better diverse schools, more economic investment, good jobs, and less prison. We want justice on the ground." Come here today, there were more buses rented and more carpools organized and more young people mobilizing than ever before. The right wing's attack on diverse schools, their obstructionist tactics toward a good jobs program, and their impediments to economic investment in the most vulnerable community has aroused people of goodwill across this state. But we also consider today, because we are a people's assembly, we consider our elders, our children, our people with special needs, the threat of ice and roads in today. And because we are a people's assembly, and unlike the ultra-right, we don't want to leave people behind. So after a thoughtful 45-minute discussion with all of the state leaders, we decided to postpone HKOMJ for 2 weeks so that all our people could come safely. Now, postponement will not mean any going down in our enthusiasm. We will use these 2 weeks to field more buses, to build the momentum of the HKOMJ move, the People's Assembly, here and across the South. This is the same week, 20 years ago, that Nelson Mandela was freed from prison, from years in prison. Prison did not stop him from his work of justice, and snow and a change of date will not stop us. 50 years ago, students on this campus with a mission, little money, facing a lot of organized racism, formed Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. The challenges did not stop them, but inspired me. A little snow and a change of date will not stop us. 2 weeks from now, we will still gather here with our more than 85 partners and coalition organizations. We will gather under our theme, "For Our Children, We Must Say Never Again to Resegregation." We will never go back. We demand more education, better diverse schools, more economic investment, good jobs, and less prison. We want justice on the ground. And we encourage all North Carolinians to save the day and join us in Raleigh. Then, the uniqueness of our agenda, the uniqueness of our agenda, is that we do not just curse the darkness or criticize what is wrong, but we offer comprehensive strategies and action steps under each of our 14 points that could fundamentally shift North Carolina's public policies toward justice and fairness. Our coalition and agenda is anti-racist, anti-poverty, anti-war, pro-justice, pro-equality, pro-environmental, and pro-everyday people.
Yes.
Today, I want to place in the hands of the media information that clearly outlines our 14-point agenda and more than 80 doable steps. The theme under which we are gathering this year is demanded by two regressive forces. First, resegregation of public schools under code words like neighborhood schools. This intentional act does nothing but create high poverty, racially identifiable schools for the poor and minorities, and creates private schools paid for with black, white, and Latino tax dollars on the other hand. The second crisis is the economic implosion caused by the forces of greed. It is devastating economic investment and good jobs in the minority and poor communities. Now, in the area of public education, the challenges have been clear. They want resegregation. Our proposals and demands are equally clear of what must be done to meet the challenge. The lines have been drawn clearly. Now, as an old song raises the question, which side are you on? North Carolina's segregated, under-resourced, and underachieving educational system is an everyday reality for many with its intentional pocket of apartheid education and what one judge called educational genocide. Listen to what is existing today in North Carolina. After decades of only modest progress to end racial and social economic segregation, many of North Carolina's school systems have abandoned or are abandoning pro-integration student assignment calls. Happening right here in Wake and in Charlotte and in Wayne and in Wilmington and across the state. During the 2008-2009 school year, less than 50% of African-American, Hispanic, and American Indian children in grades 3 to 8 achieved a proficient score on the end of grade math and reading tests. And we refuse to believe that our children are 50% less smart than white students. High school end of grade course test results were similar, with minority students proficiency less than 60% of the time and white students proficiency around 80%. Suspension rates for African-American students are nearly four times the rate of white students. American Indians create nearly three times as high. 13 years after the state Supreme Court ruling in Leandro, North Carolina's K-12 per pupil spending remains lower than all but six other states and more than 18% lower than the national average. And North Carolina's historically black colleges and universities continue to receive inadequate investment. Right now, North Carolina puts more money in prisons on a yearly basis than we do all five of our state historically black colleges and universities combined budgets together. For our children, in the light of these realities, we demand more education, better and more diverse schools. And we can change the present situation if we say never again to resegregation, and we'll never go back. If we get equal adequate funding for all schools, if we get high quality teachers in smaller classrooms, if we get a consistent focus on math and science, and if systems that promote parental involvement and fast student discipline policies are enacted. Now the challenges in the collapse of our economic system are equally clear. North Carolina has a troubled economy and tattered safety net. Right now, in North Carolina, the official unemployment rate has soared to a record 11.2%, more than a half million people. Unemployment also in the among African Americans is approaching 22%. Nine counties now have overall rates in excess of 15%. Unemployment rates are substantially higher. Rates are not expected to peak until the third quarter of this year. One in seven North Carolinians were already classified as poor before the recession of 2009. Nearly 18% of the state's population, or 1.6 million people, lack health insurance. 25% in the African-American community. More than 2 million North Carolinians live in unaffordable, inadequate, or overcrowded housing. One-third of North Carolinians. North Carolina incarcerates more than 40,000 human beings a year, the majority of which are minority, and the number has doubled in less than two decades. And despite having provided essential relief and preserving thousands of jobs, federal recovery funds remain inadequate to assist all North Carolinians in need. More help is needed.